So I went to my yoga class the other day, unrolled my mat, started to get all namaste-ish and stuff, and then, what? On the next mat over, is that my PCB? Huh? It's true. We may be used to plain old rigid boards, but more and more often these days, we need to design in some flex. We want to fold over the boards in tight spaces, or use flexible boards instead of expensive cables and connectors. Of course, before our PCB can rock the downward dog, we need to rethink our design tool strategy. Hi, I'm Amelia Dalton, host of Chalk Talk. Rigid Flex Design is here, and I'm ready to roll. Literally. So I brought in Ben Jordan from Altium to tell us about Rigid Flex support in the latest release of Altium Designer. Before we get started, remember to click the link. There you can download a free white paper entitled An Introduction to Rigid Flex PCB Design Best Practices. Welcome, Ben. Thank you so much for joining me today.
Thanks for having me, Amelia.
Okay, we're going to be talking about Rigid Flex PCBs today. Maybe we should start with an obvious question. Ben, what is a rigid flex PCB? What is it, rigid or flex?
Well, you might think it couldn't make up its mind, but it's actually both.
Okay.
A rigid flex PCB is like this one, a printed circuit board that has both rigid sections and flexible circuit sections, and they're laminated together. So parts of it are flexible, and the whole assembly can be folded up maybe into its final enclosure.
Okay.
Another example that a lot of people are familiar with, maybe not necessarily at first glance, but this is a famous rigid flexible assembly that's for connecting different parts of a well-known tablet that's very, very popular in the Bay Area.
I wonder what that is.
The good thing about this example, and the reason why I wanted to include a photograph of this one, is that it pretty clearly shows the bendy bits, which are covered in a black coverlay film.
Uh-huh.
But it's also got a lot of these lighter colored bits, which are stiffeners with adhesive or double-sided tape sections for sticking this thing into its appropriate enclosure areas.
Right.
And a key part of most flexible circuits is that usually at the terminators, it needs to be rigid anyway. So at the very least, we're going to be using some sort of stiffener.
Right.
Or thick plastic, which you can see here.
Okay, so Ben, why would I want to do a rigid flex design?
That's a good question. And rigid flex technology has been around for a long time, but it's been pretty much limited to very high-end military aerospace designs where they absolutely had to cram as much as possible into the smallest possible place. So that's one obvious reason. I mean,
gotcha.
It gives you a means of folding a lot of circuitry into a very tight package. I've got a couple of examples here. There's a handheld walkie-talkie or radio device. You can see the circuit board that came out of that or that is used in that has some flexible circuit sections for joining different rigid sections just to get the density up. And also there's an advantage there. A lot of devices like this are now using flexible circuits as part of the RF circuitry for doing antennas because it gives you more freedom on shaping the antenna.
Sure.
The left-hand side is a medical device where in order to get all the processing and sensor technology into a small, comfortable handheld package that was suitable for patient contact, the only way to fit all of that into that device was by using multiple rigid sections separated by flexible circuits.
Okay, what about a comparison between, say, a standard PCB?
That's a great question. A lot of electronic products actually have more than one PCB in them, so it's important to be able to design those things together. And usually then there's some sort of cable harness and connector set that's needed to go between them.
Right.
Often the cable harness and connector set is simple enough that it's not really a big deal. But if you need to save a lot of space, you may not have room for the connectors. And if you have signal integrity requirements that are very stringent, so let's say your design goes between two different PCBs with very high edge rate signals, cables and connectors can be a real problem for signal integrity. In those cases, it's definitely worth considering rigid flex. Rigid flex can also give you not only a higher wiring density, but it removes impedance mismatches through connectors and cables. It can also help increase electromagnetic compatibility and reduce electromagnetic interference in the circuit by keeping the signals between flexible shielding layers as well.
Gotcha. Okay, let's break it down and see how it's made.
So the typical starting point for a flexible circuit, and the rigid part is really just rigid sections laminated onto the flexible sections.
Gotcha.
So we typically start with a base film of polyamide, which could be anywhere from 1 or 2 mils thick up to a few tens of mils thick. It's very flexible, has really high temperature resistance, and a pretty good low thermal coefficient, so it doesn't expand too much. Then that's coated typically with an adhesive coating or a copper seed layer, could be plated up, and then copper foil may be laminated onto that adhesive coating. Next thing is, typically in the process, we drill the film. The drilling, because it's flexible, can be tough. The film is kept tight in a frame or on rolls, and multiple films are held together between rigid plates for the drilling process. So a lot of films are drilled at once.
Okay.
That's if it's mechanical drilling. But obviously, you know, there are limitations to the accuracy of that. The other option is they can be laser drilled or chemically etched. Laser drilling and chemical etch are able to go down to very, very small hole sizes, down to the HDI VS sizes in modern fabs. Then we have through-hole plating, where the entire thing gets a copper deposit through all the holes.
Okay.
Etch resist is then printed onto the board in the same way as it would be with a rigid board section for creating the copper pattern for the traces and component pads. And then that's etched and stripped away to leave the actual flexible circuit. And then the final stage of that is to add coverlay, which is typically laminated on, and it's more polyamide film, just like the base film. And again, typical thicknesses, 1 or 2 mils up to several mils. There are other types of coverlay that can be added, like typical PCB solder mask. It can be printed on as well.
Okay.
For single layer flex circuits, which are generally the most flexible for obvious reasons, you would do that only with a typical one-sided process where you end up with a base film with a copper foil that's then etched and holes are drilled, and an additional polyamide coverlay film is then laminated directly over the top of that for a single layer flex circuit.
Okay. So, since you're from Altium, I should assume we're going to talk about how these things are designed. What are the design considerations here?
That's a really great question. The funny thing is, up until now, I mentioned flex circuit technology and rigid flex has actually been around for a while, but because there have been a limited number of designers in the community actually using it as a technology until now, there hasn't been a real need to go beyond the copious notes that are needed for documenting it and for specifying what the fabricator needs to do in a fabrication drawing versus actually designing it in the actual software.
Gotcha.
But the biggest consideration for a rigid flex design is the requirement to have multiple different layer stacks. Most PCB editors out there only support a single layer stack design.
Right.
And so to handle rigid flex properly, the CAD tools need to be improved to handle multiple layer stacks for the different areas where there may just be a flexible circuit or multiple flex circuits over the top of each other, and then other areas where there are rigid sections as well.
Okay, so we talked about adhesives earlier, and I've heard those can be a bit of a problem. What if we're designing without adhesives?
That's a good point, and adhesives have been known in the past to cause via barrels to crack during the final assembly of the circuit. So a lot of manufacturers that make these materials are now coming out with alternatives of pre-coated films, that is pre-coated with copper, that don't use an adhesive. Rather, they have a sputtering process to attach the copper. And that works basically the same way. We don't have to specify in the layer stack where the adhesive is or whatnot. That's basically up to our fabricator, and we can tell them we want to use an adhesiveless material by specifying that in our layer stack design. We can choose what material to use, whether it's from DuPont or Rogers or any of those other manufacturers.
Okay, cool.
Even down to the part number that we want them to use.
Okay, Ben, you've got me a little worried here. I know I can't do more than one layer stack in my PCB design tools.
That's a valid concern, Amelia, and I would be concerned too, because up until now, the only PCB design tools I've ever seen have had a single homogeneous layer stack design.
Right.
This is a traditional design shown here where you just have all the different dielectrics and copper layers separated and specifying the thicknesses of each, what materials to use, and what their dielectric constants are in order to do impedance controlled routing and all of that. That's all really well and good. Mm-hmm. And we can generate an output from that in a fab drawing. But what we really need is a new layer stack manager that supports multiple different layer stack definitions, which are subsets of a master layer stack. And that's what we're looking at here.
Ah, okay.
Here's another diagram displaying that. So we can now have multiple different layer stack sections. And of course, this is pretty much customizable to the nth degree. And almost anything is manufacturable if you've got the money.
Right.
Of course, you do need to consult with your fab and understand what the fabricator is capable of and make sure that you know what the trade-offs are between what can be done versus what's going to make an economical product.
All right, that's all fine and good, but how does a designer use them?
So after the multiple layer stacks have been defined, you need to be able to specify which parts of the board are actually using those different layer stacks.
Right.
So here we have a board planning mode where I can actually separate out in a two-dimensional view of the overall board outline, which includes the flexible circuit sections. I can divide that up and slice it into different regions and assign different layer stacks to those regions.
Ah, okay. Now, Ben, this kind of looks like my R2-D2 costume pattern. I'm just saying.
The next step, of course, is you need to be able to specify not only where the flexible circuit sections are in two dimensions, but we want to be able to specify where the bends and folds will be as
right.
a starting point. Obviously, for dynamic flex applications, bends and folds can move. As a good starting point, and in order to make sure we've designed things to the right dimensions, we want to be able to show, if I put a 90 degree fold here that has this radius to fit inside my enclosure, how much space is that going to use up on the flex circuit, and do I need to adjust the length of that flex circuit section or whatever the case may be? And that's what we're looking at here.
Okay, so what is that fold slider there? What is that going to do?
This fold state slider is really important because it's all well and good having the ability to define layer stacks, specify where they are used, and even add bend lines to different areas of the flexible circuit sections. But one of the really important values of being able to do all of this and having a true 3D PCB editor is that you can simulate the bends.
Ah, yes, I can see that. That's cool.
And so right up front, before we've made anything, and we all know tooling costs for multiple rigid flex boards like this can be expensive, you want to make sure you get it right the first time.
Absolutely.
As much as possible. And this is one way of ensuring that you can do that.
All right, this looks awesome, Ben, but how do I know that my components won't bump?
Well, it's a good thing that with proper 3D simulation and true 3D PCB editors, that you can actually also have integrated design rule checking that's actually doing a design rule check real time to make sure that components don't get too close to each other.
Ah.
In this example, I've actually had a board that had a header connector on a flexible circuit, and when I bend it around, I can see that it's bent too far and all these components have flagged bright green to show me there's a clearance violation.
Cool, okay. So I'm a little worried that this is going to freak out my PCB shop, Ben. What do they need to do to get this done?
So you're asking me, what do the PCB fabricators really need to be confident and comfortable here?
Yeah.
And I've actually asked a bunch of different PCB houses what they thought, because I want to make sure that we can give them what's needed to get the job right the first time. And they all pretty much said, just give us ODB++ or Gerber, and make sure that you've got a really good fab drawing in there that shows us where the different flexible circuit sections are and the different layer stacks are implemented.
Yeah.
And I just threw up IPC 2581 there. It's not really fully finished yet, but I'm kind of hoping that it will have direct provisions for flexible circuit stack ups. But we'll see. Watch this space.
Okay, so this is still making me a little nervous. Do I need to jump on a plane and head to the fab, or is my design going to get buried in lots and lots of emails?
It shouldn't. And, you know, that's always been the traditional problem with getting these things out the door and done right the first time is all the notes that are needed.
Right.
Communication still really is the most important thing, but it's going to be a lot easier with tools like this fab drawing, where you can actually add a layer stack to your fab drawing from the layer stack planning tool. And in addition to just giving you a table that shows you all the different materials and what the stack up is, it shows each different layer stack with a different patterned crosshatch, and it gives you a little preview of the board in 2D showing where those different areas are.
Very cool. See, I told them.
And yeah, that's right. Include that in your fabrication documents and there's no excuses.
Very nice.
I mentioned before that we can simulate the bends and folds in 3D in the PCB editor, which is really important. But Altium users will know that for some time we've had the ability to create 3D videos from our PCB editor as one of the standard outputs that you can generate. And fabs more and more really appreciate getting those 3D videos, not just for knowing how the board's going to look, but also for a final assembly when they're going to mount the components and make sure everything fits and put it through reflow.
Hmm.
So the simulated folds and bends of the flex circuits are inherently supported by the 3D movie generation. So what you can actually do if you want to remove all ambiguity is actually make a little movie, an MP4 file or a WMV that you can email off to the fab or include with your documentation package when you send it to them on a thumb drive or a DVD that you burn.
Cool.
And so they can watch that video and have absolute confidence that they understand what it is you want to make.
Okay, so obviously a flexible circuit is going to be under a whole different set of design considerations than a rigid one, right? What should we be aware of?
There's quite a few design considerations. I'll mention just a few here. For example, when you're designing a flex circuit terminator and you need to have thin copper traces, which you want to be thin for flexibility, moving to larger pads for soldering to a component or going into a connector, rather than abruptly changing the trace width, that will cause a weak spot. So you want to taper it off and do it gently.
Okay.
Another design consideration is when you have double-sided flex circuits and you need copper traces on top and bottom of the flex circuit, it's best to stagger the copper placement from top to bottom so that the bend stresses are evened out between top and bottom and you don't wind up with copper traces on the top cracking.
That makes sense, yeah.
Similar to that, we don't like changing direction of the copper traces abruptly with hard angles like 45 or 90 degree angles.
Sure.
We'd rather use corners in an arc mode that's a nice gentle sweeping corner because that helps even out the stresses during bending and folding operations. And also, when you have a flex circuit coming out that is not just straight but changing directions, you don't want to put folds or bends on the corners if possible. If you can avoid it, it's best to put those on the straight sections only.
That
of course,
makes sense.
Different designs are going to have different requirements and may depend on whether the design's going to cause the flex circuit to be constantly in motion or whether it's just going to be folded once or twice for installing into the final housing. So
sure.
It really depends on all those things. Another consideration is often you might want to get a power or ground plane across a flex circuit from one rigid board to another rigid board section. You could use solid copper, but that's going to make it a lot less flexible.
Right.
So it's better to use hatched polygon pores. In this example, I've made a honeycomb pattern hatch because that evens out the stresses of bending in three different angles versus just two.
Ah, okay, I got it.
Another consideration that has to be thought of is whether the pads or vias on the flex circuit are supported or unsupported.
Okay.
A supported pad is one that's basically a plated through hole where you've got double-sided flex. But a lot of flex circuits are single-sided. So a pad only has copper on one side and it can pretty easily peel away from the polyamide base film.
Got it, okay.
So for those situations, it's actually cool to use the coverlay, which is the additional polyamide film that is laminated over the top of the copper, which is also a solder mask layer, and have that overlap the edges of pads and vias to support them and provide some extra mechanical strength there. One other trick you can do is you can add extra little Shrek ears to pads that stick up underneath the coverlay film and give it some mechanical strength there.
Cool, okay.
Similarly with surface mount components, it's good to start and finish the surface mount pad lands under the coverlay openings as well, so they too get a lot of extra strength. And this is also important if the flexible circuit underneath is moving around and there are rigid components mounted to it. You want those pads to be pretty strong.
Yeah, okay.
There's a whole lot more besides just these few. I mean, I've just given like three or four different examples here. Another one is the bend radius. You can specify what your minimum bend radius should be for a flex circuit section, and that depends on how many layers of copper there are in the flex circuit and what the application is and what type of materials you're using. If you're using rolled annealed copper, it's a bit stronger and able to be flexed more tightly and frequently versus electro-deposited copper, which is a bit weaker and more likely to fatigue and crack early on. It also depends whether or not your flex circuit is constantly going to be in motion or whether it's just going to be folded into its final assembly, which the IPC call flex to install, as you can see here. All the different considerations that have been gleaned from the experience of hundreds of designers over the years is actually captured in IPC 2223, which has just been updated. And that's a really, really good guideline. I strongly recommend following IPC 2223 when you're designing a flex or rigid flex board.
Okay, Ben, let's change gears here and talk about embedded components.
It's good to talk about embedded components because this is really a natural extension of the ability of having multiple layer stacks. So quite beyond being able to do rigid flex or flex circuit design, now that we can build multiple layer stacks, we can actually define areas of the board where rigid board dielectrics can actually be milled out to create cavities inside the board, and you can mount components inside the cavities.
Cool. Finally a place to hide the bodies.
In order to understand how this is going to work, let's look at how a typical embedded component board might be built up. Step one is you would have the traditional rigid dielectric core, usually FR408 or something like that, which is laminated and etched both sides. It may be through-hole drilled for buried vias, which are on the inner layer of the board that we will finally end up with. Then we can optionally add extra prepreg buildups with additional copper plating and pattern etching. And the next step, step three, would be a first assembly phase where solder paste is deposited and embedded components like capacitors, resistors, maybe even some semiconductors are actually mounted on the board and sent through a first phase of reflow soldering.
Okay.
And then that comes out. It has to be kept very clean because the next step is we're going to laminate on prepreg buildups that have cutouts. And those cutouts are designed to fit around the components that are already mounted onto that inner board section.
Gotcha. Okay.
Another intermediate step here would often be to fill those voids and cutouts where the components are now mounted inside them with a filling material like epoxy to make sure that there's no air bubbles inside that can cause delamination of the final board stack up. The next step is to add final prepreg buildup layers or final dielectric buildup layers and final copper plating for the outer layers of the board, and then through-hole drilling through the entire board assembly and through-hole plating, etching of the pattern, and finally solder mask and final assembly with all the surface mount and other through-hole components mounted on the board and put through reflow.
All right, this looks like some seriously risky business here, Ben. Putting all sorts of stuff inside the board like this?
It can be, and this is why only some of the most elite manufacturers have been able to do this until now. But again, like rigid flex, it's getting more prevalent, more popular. Even the phone that I have, which is produced by the millions, actually has the main application processing unit embedded in an inner layer of the board, and the memory is mounted on top of that.
Ah.
So it's becoming more prevalent. And with the right tools and the right documentation and the right partnership with the right fab, it's definitely doable. But of course, like any cutting edge technology, you're going to have to be prepared for maybe a lower yield overall than what you're used to.
Right. Okay, Ben, what does this look like in the tool?
Here's what it looks like in the tool. We can now actually take a component that from the PCB design library is just a regular surface mount component like this capacitor that we're seeing here, decoupling cap, mm-hmm. that has land patterns on the top layer of the board, and just simply specify that this component is not on top layer anymore, but now it's actually on mid layer too.
Ah, okay.
The cool thing is the tool knows that the component protrudes still towards the top unless I specify otherwise by flipping the component over as if it were a bottom mounted component. But I can just set the layer that I want the component on and it will go to that layer, and the tool will create a cutout for it to fit it. I can also manually create cutouts because I might want to place a bunch of components like a chip and all of its decoupling caps together within the same cavity.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Here's another example of a decoupling cap that was just pushed down one layer into the copper of the board. And the cap is tall enough that the cavity actually creates an opening in the top of the board, which you can see there. And that's also doable. And we might provide information to the fab that we want them to squeegee some epoxy over that and fill it in.
Ben, I'm pretty sure I've played this game on the Xbox. So how do I hand this over to my fabricator?
So what the fabricators need in this case, again, is still the same thing. I've quizzed a bunch of them and they say, yeah, ODB++ would do, or Gerber,
mm-hmm.
or the more cutting edge ones, IPC 2581 would be nice. Really what it boils down to, again, is good communication. And because the cavities actually become items in the design, we can generate more fab documentation where they're clearly visible. You can see a screenshot of some here that I've done, where the cavities for an RF circuit are actually shown there in green.
Oh, okay.
So it's very clear that we can give good documentation to the fab, that they can see clearly where they need to route out sections of inner dielectrics, and again, no excuses.
Well, shoot, I think I'm ready to start designing some rigid flex components. Thank you so much for joining me today, Ben. It was a pleasure speaking with you.
And with you, Amelia. And don't forget, IPC provide really good design guidelines. Stick to these. IPC 2316 is a good guide for embedded passives.
Before we go, remember to click the link. There you can download a free white paper entitled An Introduction to Rigid Flex PCB Design Best Practices. For Chalk Talks, I'm Amelia Dalton. For more Chalk Talks, check out the EE Journal channel on YouTube or the on-demand section on EEJournal.com.